Who are you?
That's a good question.
This is a young man who grew out of a need. He came here, he came to be as he is, because things needed saying, and the young people were the ones who wanted to say them, and they wanted to say them in their own way. He somehow had an ear on his generation, and he has set a pace for many people, and is now, well, he's now continuing in the same way, and there are many others that are joining him. I don't have to tell you, you know him, he's yours, Bob Dylan.
This is Carl. It's all right, Ma, I'm only bleeding, ho, ho, ho.
This young man was born in Duluth, Minnesota. He started playing the guitar when he was just a child of 10, but he says it didn't do him too much good in high school. He says his only trouble with playing guitar is you don't get the cheerleader girls. He is now one of the most sought-after folk artists. I think one of the reasons for his popularity is that he has the mind of a poet.
I've been playing, you know, on the stage since I've been 10. I was singing Muddy Waters songs, and I was writing songs, and I was singing Woody Guthrie songs. For 15 years, I've been doing what I've been doing.
Rambling out in the Wild West, leaving the towns I love the best. Thought I'd seen some ups and downs till I came into New York town.
You see, when he came to New York, one of his prime motives was to meet Woody Guthrie, and Woody was in the hospital with Huntington's chorea. And he used to play and sing for Woody.
There I met Bob, and Bob was young, and he was just recently arrived in New York. And we ended up staying at the same hotel, the Earl Hotel. The guitar picker was home away from home. So we became fast friends. And he'd get up and do stuff that I had just done. They'd say, "Well, he's stealing the wind out of your sails." I said, "Oh, I got plenty of wind in my sails." I says, "He just likes Woody Guthrie and sings like the real guys do."
When I was a kid at school, that's all I wanted to be, really, was Bob Dylan.
I was a huge fan of early Dylan because at one point I was a folkie. I had an acoustic guitar and a harmonica around my neck.
I had my coat hanger and my little harmonica holder and guitar when I was 14, you know, like all the other guys.
And the first thing I played was old folk songs, Green Sleeves.
There was this folk scene going on. It was the bohemians, the folkies and the poets, the comedians would come out of little coffee houses, like the Gaslight Cafe was a really popular one. Dave Van Ronk used to run the Hootenannies there, and Dylan would go in, and people would go in and try their new material there.
And at 19, I had my first professional job. I sang around town, and I had versions of I know where I'm going, and I know who's going with me. I know who I love, but the devil knows who I'll marry. All kinds of wonderful songs that drifted to me from various singers.
Those clubs provided a nucleus for an instrumental style and a musical style. It evolved out of crushing young modern songwriters in with bluegrass players, old-timey music people, commie folk singers from New York City, 60 and 70-year-old blues men.
I'm gonna do it, Alan. I'm gonna get me a mojo hand. I'm gonna Louisiana. Boys, I'm gonna get me a mojo hand. I didn't wanna fix my woman so. Can't have no other man.
That happened was the rules were being broken. No longer was it a matter of singing Earth Angel and Rock Around the Clock, you had people like Bob Dylan. He is one of the great examples of someone who studied and knew the songs of all the 50s bands and knew all the blues writing and began to write in his own way. And other songwriters began to do the same thing, writing about current politics.
Oh, I marched to the Battle of New Orleans at the end of the early British wars. The young land started growing, the young blood started flowing, but I ain't marching anymore.
When we all used to work these coffee houses, the way they would pay us would be to pass a basket around. And if Richie had been in that night, there wouldn't be any money left because he was so good that he'd get all the money.
Those people were in the very first days of their acts, and that was part of the magic, as you saw creativity. So writing became was big. There was a lot of poetry still. There was writing of songs. There was the beginning of creating social awareness through art.
How many years can a mountain exist before it?
In competition. We were students of the same muse. If somebody did a song of yours, you were blown away that they would even think, you know, that your song was important enough to do.
How many times can a man turn his head and pretend that he just doesn't see?
I remember Bobby Dylan was living with me in Woodstock for the summer when A Blowing in the Wind came out. And there was a sense of the enormous moment of the linkage of the music to the political movements of our time.
That movement of the 60s really had a huge impact on my consciousness when I was a child. I was very aware of the civil rights movement and the part that the music played in it.
Little baby, don't you cry. You know your mama was born to die.
Oh, my child.
You'd hear Bob Dylan, Joan Baez, Richie Havens, and the music was part of the culture. You'd go to the rallies and you'd hear the music.
Come gather round people wherever you roam, and admit that the waters around you have grown, and accept it that soon you'll be drenched to the bone. If your time to you is worth saving, then you better start swimming or you'll sink like a stone, for the times, they are a-changing.
Every summer throughout the early 60s, fans came from around the country to the Newport Folk Festival. They came to hear everything from old-timey string bands to the newest singer-songwriters.
Ain't gonna work on the railroad, ain't gonna work on the farm. Lay around the shack till a mail train come back, then I'll roll in my sweet baby's arms.
It was a tradition, but in the summer of 1965, Bob Dylan introduced 110 volts of electricity that turned tradition on its ear.
The Newport Folk Festival was a great ideal. This was the era when kids held hands and sang We Shall Overcome. And they hated rock and roll.
One, two, three.
By 1965, Bob Dylan was an immense star.
So Dylan comes out with some friends of his.
Got the tape. Bring it up again, Paul.
Bring that tape up here.
Let's get that tape.
They were setting equipment up on the stage, and we'd never seen this equipment because it was some heavy sound equipment. We didn't know what he was going to do. Nobody knew what he was going to do. This explosion of sound came from the stage, and the people, the audience, and the people backstage were totally shocked. We'd never heard this kind of volume at the folk festival.
Hey, there's this girl got in your face just for kicks. His bedroom window, it is made out of bricks. The National Guard stands around his door. I ain't gonna work for Maggie's paw no more.
The audience was in an uproar. There was screaming, there was booing. It was really bad. Pete Seeger ran into a car and sat in a car holding his ears, and he says, George, stop that sound. I says, Pete, I can't stop that sound.
I ain't gonna work for Maggie's ma no more.
The Beatles were doing a benefit at the old Paramount, and I just thought that Lennon and Dylan ought to meet. They deserved to meet. We were backstage, and Dylan stood in the wings on a chair. And of course, you couldn't hear the concert. You could hear nothing but the girls screeching. So after that night, we had my wife drive him over to a place where he rented an electric guitar. Brought it back to my house and started fiddling around with it. And after that, he went electric.
I ain't gonna work for Maggie's ma no more.
A lot of people were angry. I know for a fact that a lot of people felt betrayed.
It wasn't a controversy about acoustic versus electric. It was a controversy about making music that had the integrity.
I ain't gonna work on Maggie's farm no more.
It seemed inconceivable that somebody could also have as much integrity and be playing rock and roll. Didn't make sense to them. And so they got furious.
Oh, I try my best to be just like I am, but everybody wants you to be just like them. They say sing while you slave, I just get bored. I ain't gonna work on Maggie's farm tomorrow.
Were you surprised the first time the blues came?
Yeah, they were. That was at Newport. Well, I did this very crazy thing. So, you know, I mean, I didn't really know what was going to happen. But they certainly booed, I'll tell you that. You could hear it all over the place.
His name is Bob Dylan.
Well, first of all, it was the moment that separated the men from the boys. To me, it was the signal that we'd now grown up, we'd now come of age when Dylan went electric, and we could now do anything and everything, and we did it.
Yeah. When the subject matter got very broad into all kinds of areas.
You're going to the final school, all right. Mr. Lonely, but you're the only one we used to get just in.
He predicted some of the fragmentation of thought, of images, of the society itself.
He's not just mixing it up album by album or song by song. With him, it's line by line. You know, you move into a different world with the next line.
Now you realize he's not telling any alibis. As you step into the vacuum of his eyes and say, do you want to make a deal?
Felt about displacement.
How does it feel to be without a home?
Without a home, that's how you felt.
With no direction home.
To be on your own, that's how you felt.
Like I can't believe it.
All of a sudden, everything is up for grabs.
Like a rolling stone.
really painted a picture of what was going on around him. You know, he's Picasso to me of rock and roll.
He is by far my favorite writer and my favorite singer.
Bob Dylan.
Bob Dylan.
Bob Dylan.
Bob Dylan.
Bob Dylan.
Bob Dylan, I think, absolutely influenced everything that came after him in pop music, or rock music, or folk music, and probably in R&B. He
was the king of folk music at that time, and he went over to England and met with the Beatles. He said, "You guys, you don't say anything. You have nothing to say." And it really shocked Lennon. Lennon really, you know, he really was taken back by this because he was a tremendous admirer of Dylan's. And he started writing more intellectual lyrics after that. And by the same token, Dylan started experimenting with music more. So the two of them really influenced each other in a profound way.
So you had the Dylan influence on the lyrics and the Beatles influence on the music, and a whole new music was born.
Folky thing like, "Hey, Mr. Tambourine Man, play a song for me," and I put it in. "Hey, Mr. Tambourine Man, play a song for me."
Jim McGuinn went to see Hard Day's Night, took us all to see it. He saw that 12-string guitar in George Harrison's hand. I think we saw it at the Pix Theater on Hollywood Boulevard. And that was it. And my hands
can't feel too red. I was playing an acoustic 12-string from my folk days, but it wasn't getting the same sound. And George Harrison had this great sounding guitar. It looked like a 6-string, though. It looked like this. And then he turned it sideways, and I went, aha, that's what it is. It's a 12-string electric. So I went out the next day and got one. Go anywhere, I'm
ready for to play. What Jim did with the 12-string was pretty amazing. It was a big part of it. And the harmonies, David Crosby approached his harmony singing totally unlike anybody.
There was a chemistry. You know, I'm a natural harmony singer. It's what I was put here to do, you know, and anytime either one of them would start anything, I would start singing harmony to it.
Gene Clark and I would sing unison, and Crosby would sing a composite part of, developed from thirds and fourths and fifths of, you know, the melody. I guess he was inspired by the Everly Brothers. It was basically just two-part harmony, but because Crosby was popping around in the different areas of harmony, it sounded like more harmony than it really was. I started incorporating the 4-4 beat with folk music, and I started doing these things in the village. I was living in the Earl Hotel, and John Phillips and Michelle were in a suite on the second floor, and I used to go down to the room and hang out with them, and we'd jam.
We were all in the village playing the same clubs, and this turnaround, you know, this carousel.
There was no business in California then. It was all New York. And we had gone to New York to live in New York, to work out of New York. And I was obviously very, very homesick.
And we decided to just go somewhere, you know, and we let Michelle throw a dart at the world globe, you know, and it landed on St. Thomas. And that's where we went. And after 4 months, we came back to New York. And no one was in New York. Roger wasn't there. Crosby wasn't there. It goes on and on. To LA, and And lo and behold, everyone was in L.A. with record contracts, you know? Well, I got down on my knee,
and I pretend to play. It was a time of L.A. becoming a rock center, a music center. Young musicians were moving here from everywhere else. And there was a whole generic kind of music that was truly peculiar and particular to Los Angeles. It was surfing music. Obviously, the greatest practitioner of surf music were the Beach Boys.
Beach Boys could see that the times were changing, and Brian Wilson knew that his band had to change too.
Brian Wilson was in a situation that was very commercial. He was being asked to perpetuate that commerciality and did for quite a while.
I got a phone call from Brian. He was extremely depressed about the prospects of having to go out on the road.
Brian's quitting the road was very traumatic. And he was really getting into difficulty in those days.
I had a nervous breakdown as a result of it. I couldn't handle the strain of going on tour. I just couldn't handle that kind of strain. It was like, you had to get up every morning, you had to get on a plane, you had to go places. I couldn't handle the strain.
In truth, there was just too much pressure on him. He couldn't be writing and arranging and producing and then going out on the road with this stuff because there was just too much to do.
When he said, I'm not gonna tour anymore, and he went in and started making much more elaborate, sophisticated music, he came to the conclusion that there were other things to look into that had more to do with personal musical growth.
So we went in the studio, trying to get something happening where we would be better musically than the Beatles. We realized that they had something like, I want to hold you. They had more electricity than we had, you know? But we wanted to do something that had more musical merit than the Beatles. So we made Pet Sounds, which was Paul McCartney's favorite album.
I may not always love you, but long as there are stars above you, you'll never need to doubt it. I'll make you so sure about it. God only knows what I'd be without.
I wrote that for Carl. It took me 20 minutes. Nobody believes this story, you know. But I mean, just to get like, you know, that chord pattern. It took me 20 minutes to get that whole chord pattern. It took about 2 hours to get the lyrics, but 20 minutes.
I may not always love you, as long as there are stars above you, you'll never need to doubt it. I'll make you so sure about it. God only knows what I'd be without you.
When we made Pet Sounds, we made it based on prayer sessions. Carl and I would pray for people. We'd get together at my house in Beverly Hills, and we'd sit at this big round table, you know, and we'd turn the dimmer switch way down low to where we could almost not see each other, you know, and sometimes he'd lead the prayer session, and sometimes I'd lead the prayer session, and you know, but we always prayed. We prayed that the Lord help us make a spiritual album for people. Well, sure enough, the Lord did.
I know that Paul and the others admired it too. They wanted to be able to write music as good as that or better than that. It was their yardstick, and it was a competitive thing.
Pet Sounds proved that pop music could be as sophisticated as a symphony. More and more musicians began experimenting and testing the limits. Albums became artworks, and the whole world was listening.
It was a weird time. It was like everything was happening simultaneously. The other thing was FM radio came into the forefront, and all of a sudden, kids were exposed to music that weren't hit singles. All of a sudden, FM was playing album cuts.
FM opened up the door to underground music, and that's why it was so important back in the 60s. Tom Donahue programmed the first underground radio station up in San Francisco, and Tom was playing music that was being listened to by college students and young people, and maybe even being played in clubs, but really had no exposure.
Somebody listened to FM might not even know a top 10 single, and somebody listened to AM would have no idea who Jimi Hendrix was.
Jimi Hendrix was the first proper electronic composer, because I think he was the first one who listened to what he was doing.
Jimi Hendrix was an envelope pusher. He was kicking with extreme force at all the boundaries of music. We were neighbors. He lived a block away from me. And we played together a lot in late night jams in the village.
Hendrix had a group called Jimmy James and the Flames, and they played in the village at the same time I was playing in the village. And he couldn't buy a record contract, you know.
Once upon a time, if you were a black guy in America, you didn't get to the same opportunities. And he had to go to England. We're English guitar freaks, you know. We love guitars. They're sort of like another organ on your body.
I remember the first time he played in London was down a club called the Bag of Nails. Everyone was there.
Seeing Jimi Hendrix for the first time, hell of a lot of pain. Pained because in his presence and in the presence of that music, you felt small and you realized how far you had to go. And I think Eric Clapton suffered with that as well. We were both really, really shaken by, oh God, you know, what has happened to us? You know, a tornado called Jimi Hendrix.
I saw Jimi Hendrix and I think it's time to quit.
Underground was erupting, transforming the musical and cultural landscape. And in 1967, Jimi Hendrix returned home to a whole new world.
Monterey is very groovy, man. This is something, man. This is our generation, man. All you people, we're all together, man, and it's groovy. And dig yourselves, because it's really groovy.
What began as a small scene in Greenwich Village had turned into a cultural revolution.
The suit and tie men were not part of that show, and since there was not a commercial element, it was really up from the people. And that was unprecedented. We're going to do a show, and it's not about money or sales. It's for free. And everybody did work for free except Ravi Shankar, who came from India with his sitar and had to make $3,000.
Monterey was the first time Hendrix ever played for an American audience. It was the first time Otis Redding ever played for a white audience. It was the first time the San Francisco groups had ever played for an international audience outside the city limits of San Francisco.
Woodstock gets the lion's share of the attention, but this was the real groundbreaker. It legitimized rock and roll as a concert art form.
No more will my gray seagull turn a deeper blue, blue, blue. I could not foresee this thing ever happening to you.
So we tried to find the most talented people who hadn't been exposed.
I first met Janis backstage at the Fillmore in San Francisco, and I'd been told that if I went back to the backstage entrance, the artist entrance, that I would get in free. And then the door opened, you know, and Janis was standing there, you know, and said, "Hey, Eric, welcome to the Fillmore," you know, and she shook my hand, you know, and. As I pulled my hand away, I looked and there was a hit of LSD in my hand, you know. And I just,
Some came along, 100 gram to hold her, and it felt like a ball and chain.
By what had happened at Monterey, I knew it was going to herald a social revolution. It was the purest form of love and peace and caring I had ever witnessed before or since.
It was, you know, peace, love, and flowers. Played with The Who at Murray the K's Easter show. So at the Monterey staff meetings, I would say, just know that these guys are going to come out and wreck everything. You know, I would suggest that they close.
Couldn't deal with the idea that at this critical concert we might go on after Jimmy.
And he said to me, you want to be first up there with the guitar smasher. So I said, Jimmy, I swear to you, that's not what it's about. And Jimmy started to play. He stood on a chair in front of me and he started to play. It was just Jimmy on a chair playing at me. Playing at me like that. You know, don't fuck with me, you little shit. And then he snapped out of it and he put the guitar down and he said, okay, let's toss a coin. So we tossed a coin and we got to go on first. He then went on immediately after us, I think. I don't think there was anybody in between. So I went out to sit with Mama Cass to watch Jimmy. And as he started doing the stuff with his guitar, she turned around to me, she said to me, he's stealing your act. And I said, no, he's not stealing my act. He's doing my act.
The Who and Jimmy were determined to outdo each other. And I'm not sure who really won, you know. I mean, Jimmy humped the amp, broke his guitar, burned it up in flames. The Who blew up the entire stage.
Both acts, both The Who and Hendrix, smashed up equipment during their appearance there. And yet, one is like a violent rape, and the other is like an erotic sacrifice.
We didn't know that you could do that, you know? He's lighting that thing on fire! How dare they break up a drum set? They obviously had gotten a new sense of theatrics that nobody had, you know, even conceived of previously.
You know, what The Who were doing was transcendent in a lot of ways, but what Jimmy was doing was sublimely... it was an epiphany.
Like a Rolling Stone.
There's nobody like him. I mean, there really isn't. I mean, there's Dylan and Hendrix and, you know, who else, you know?
Once upon a time, you're dressed so fine. Through the bumps of diamond in your prime. Or didn't you? People call, say, but we're dull. You're bound to fall, you thought they all. Well, couldn't you?
There was something really important happening, which was that this great music that we've discovered, this great music which is still growing, this music which now you can write songs about what's really happening deep, deep, deep inside of you and what's happening around you in the world, can also sound extraordinary.
You don't, baby, seem so proud.
That was just a step-by-step progression of just expanding the whole idea of anything is possible. There were no rules, and you can do whatever you want. Before that, there were rules. Only certain kind of songs were deemed capable of succeeding on the radio or the pop landscape. But the Beatles broke all those rules and got away with it, as Bob Dylan did here in his own early way, as people like the Byrds followed up on.
The bohemian element that had been a minority became a majority. It seemed to take over the whole planet.
Yeah, like a rolling stone.
sense of, yeah, there's a future. There's a future for us all, even though, you know, the world was in flames over in Asia.
Exchanging all precious gifts and things, but you better take your diamond ring. I think you better. You better pawn it, babe. Yes, I know, Mr. Burns, don't worry. You used to be so amused at the pulling rags, and a sweet talk daddy you. Go to him now, he calls you. You can't refuse. When you ain't got nothing, you got nothing to lose. Yeah, people now, you got no secrets.